Hey, why don't we get this party launched here?
Well, welcome you to the opening event for James Girt's exhibit, which is taking place over at the Hamden Gallery. And if you haven't seen it, it's worth a trip over there. It's entering deep into student land, but it's well worth the trip. I'm Will Cox. I work at Special Collections right now. I know some of the people on the panel here, not everybody, but I'm really glad to welcome everybody here today, and I'm particularly happy to see an event that celebrates photography. Oddly enough, when I arrived here around 12 years ago, one of the first rare books, if you want to call it that we brought into the department here was a book that was illustrated with real photographs tipped in. And it was a fad, if you want to call it a fad, a mania, that ran from about 1854 to the 1880s here. And Massachusetts was a leader in that. The very first two books with photographically illustrated that way were both produced in Massachusetts, one of which was produced here in Pioneer Valley. And that was the book that I brought in when I arrived here around 12 years ago. So it's really nice to feel like we're coming full circle and having this. So let me just introduce to you our panelists today, and I'll go in alphabetical order just for the sake of having written it that way. First, we have Paula Ferrario, who received her BA in photography from San Francisco Art Institute, an MFA from Yale. She's completed since then a number of projects in Italy, Guatemala, Turkey, and the United States, and you'll see that there's a lot of commonality between the people on the panel here, oddly enough. She received enough awards to embarrass the Russian Tsar. I'm pretty sure that's fair. She's been Friends of Photography, Calumet, and Immersion Photographer. Paul Davis, Dorothea Lange Prize from Duke, Hoffman Foundation grantee, a Guggenheim Fellow, Harnish Visiting Fellow at Smith, etc., etc., etc. And she's the author of the book, 19 Pictures and 22 Recipes, which is very well worth a look right over there. James Girt, who's the sacrificial goat today, I guess, in the middle, is a fine art photographer who's based in East Hampton. And I have to stress East Hampton, that's every chance I get. From 99 to 2006, James worked as a lab manager at the Chicago Albion Works, which many of you will know is a really remarkable photo conservation lab. And he got to work there, I'm going to have to give the air quotes around work, with negatives of photographers like Walker Evans and Carl Hawkins and Laszlo Molinage. Since 2007, he's worked at Nantolia College as digitization coordinator, and I'll cut through a number of the awards that he's won because he knows what they are. But it's important to point out that James has also published 7 self-published books in the past 8 years, including the one that's sitting on there. Wait, did you bring more than one or did you bring the one? You just brought the one. The Way of Air, which is a really beautiful, beautiful production. Justin Kimball has a BFA in photography from RISD, an MFA from Yale, and he's also similarly well-accomplished grantee and awardee, including yet another Guggenheim Fellow in photography and Siskin Visual Photographers Fellowship, and a grant from the Kittredge Fund at Harvard. His photographs have appeared very widely in photographic magazines, and he's the author of Where We Find Ourselves and Pieces of Spain. I know Pieces of Spain is over there, and I'll offer your perusing and hopefully purchasing after the end. Tony Lee, who will have to leave, unfortunately, a little bit early today due to other commitments, is an art historian, critic, curator, and photographer. That's many, many different things all in one. He's a critic and scholar. He writes about American photography, modernist painting between the period 1860 and 1960. He's a photographer. He documents ethnic and immigrant communities. He teaches lecture courses on art since the French Revolution, seminars on photography before and after World War II. He's a recipient of a number of prizes, etc. Charles Elwood Prize for Distinguished Scholarship in American Art, given by the Smithsonian, Cultural Studies Book Prize, etc. Given by the Association of Asian American Studies, and he's founder and editor of the Defining Moments in American Photography series. And finally, Stephen Peter Dorsey is an artist and freelance photographer who lives in Northampton. I thought you were in Florence. I want to be more specific because we have a discerning audience here.
So he's been up here for more than 40 years, but my understanding is that 40 years up here has not really expunged his inner New Yorker. His work's been exhibited in collections all around the U.S., as well as in Denmark, Chile, Germany, Montreal. One of these people on the panel have gone very international. He received his B.A. from Amherst College, and you don't hold that against him. His M.F.A. from RISD. He's taught at Smith, Hampshire, and UConn and Amherst, which only begs the point why we haven't gotten to teach here a little bit more. He's won many awards, including the WHO Photography Competition in 2002, Polaroid International Photography Awards, Northampton Arts Council grants, many, and numerous others. And he's the author of The Meadows, which I believe is also up there. So we have a really distinguished man, a really great group of people. All their books are out here, well, not all their books, but many books are out here to purchase to look through. And I'll welcome our first speaker.
Thanks, Rob. Thank you, James, for inviting me for this. And once again, I want to apologize for having to leave a little early. So after my talk, I will just kind of make a side exit over to there. That empty space over there afterwards, just imagine that I'm actually there, able to answer your questions. James asked me today to talk a little bit about photography in the book in a kind of historical sense. And when he first asked me this, I thought, oh my God, this is an enormous topic. In fact, you know, photography has a relationship with the book from photography's very, very beginning. We know that in 1844, photography's inventor, one of its inventors, William Henry Fox Talbot, published a lot of his findings in The Pencil of Nature, a six-installment book that he had hoped would be bound to become part of people's libraries. And so, at least at its very beginning, photography could not escape its relationship with the book. Even some of the words that were used then, as well as today, when we print a photograph, in fact, it sounds rather bookish. Okay. So what I thought I would do is to try to talk, it was a very few case studies about certain kinds of paths of the relationship between photography and the book that lead us to where we are today. And where we are today is quite variable, but I will take as my starting point. The books of our panelists here. Okay. What we see here on the screen is Justin, the cover for Justin's book and for Stephen's book. And I take what they say in their books quite seriously. So I'm going to read to you, I hope it's not embarrassing them too much, some of what they say in their introduction. So this is what Justin says in the prologue of Where We Find Ourselves. So you just picked up this book, you're ready to kind of dive into it. There's a word from the author and photographer at the beginning, and this is what he says. For me to write about these photographs seems in many ways futile. Like bad movie subtitles, something is always lost. Once you read this, it will forever color your response. So, continue if you must. But if it were me, I would stop now. Go to the beginning of the sequence and look at the pictures. That is what they were meant for. And it seems to me that that encapsulates one very familiar feature about the way in which photo books are formulated now. Photos resists the words that often accompany them. Photos are often offered as a kind of counter to, and oftentimes a contrast to, the words that offer the framework. And yet, interestingly enough, this very kind of defiance of words in photography takes place within the confines of a book. And so I would say that, you know, one important feature about the way in which photography has a relationship with the book is this thing I would call independence, but sort of dependence. And it's kind of this tension between the two of them that animates a lot of the kind of photographic projects. Okay, so let me turn now to the Stephen's intro to The Meadows. So he says, for the last 7 years, I have started my days by walking my dog Milo in the meadow. At first, I noticed little about my surroundings, since I was often preoccupied with the details of my life. I thought about art, work, bills to be paid, calls and messages to be returned, and errands that needed to be done. The dog did what dogs do. As I watched the endless pleasure he took in running, sniffing, marking, and chasing things, it dawned on me that he was exquisitely in the present, without apparent concern for anything else. I began to try shedding my thoughts and concerns, and as I did, I couldn't help but notice the beauty and magic of what was around me. The landscape of meadows changes with the light, the weather, and the seasons. Things live, grow, die, and decay there. As both the dog and I get older, I can't help but see how much this cycle mirrors that of our own lives. And so I would say that, as Stephen very eloquently put it in his introduction, one other very familiar feature of the photo book these days is its fascination with the place. The experience of the place and the ways in which photographs both mirror, meditate on, and express that experience. And yet, often, the relationship between those things is best explored within a book. I would say that if Justin offers for us the independence but dependence of photography in the book, I would say that Stephen offers for us the revelation of place as only offered to us in the confines of the book. Okay, there are many paths, historically, that lead us to this point. I'll give us three of many that help us think about how this came about. So, the first of those paths, sorry, I'm not being very good at this thing right here. Okay. The first of those paths, really we could say, takes place in the 1860s, when the first books that are produced for a mass distribution are created. And interestingly enough, two Scotsmen are at the center of it all, right? One of them, a man named Alexander Gardner from Edinburgh and Glasgow, arrives in this country and makes his name photographing both celebrities in and around Washington, D.C., and the battle sites and the kind of events of the Civil War. The second Scotsman, a man named John Thompson, also from Edinburgh in Scotland, spends much of his time in South Asia, Southeast Asia, and East Asia, photographing the kinds of things that he sees there, and he brings these books back. What's interesting for us is that at a certain moment in time, both men believe that their photographs, taken in a variety of circumstances for many different kinds of audiences, ought to be collected in a book format. And in doing so, they put themselves into dialogue with things, historical narrative and travelogue, that had previously been the province of words. And in fact, the way in which we can even see these books today is to suggest that the photographs begin to appear as merely accompaniment for the words. And so if we take a look at, for example, a famous set of pages from Gardner's photo sketchbook of the Civil War, we'll find what's often referred to on the left screen here as the letterpress, and over on the right, the tipped-in photograph that accompanies that letterpress. Let me read to you what the letterpress says, and it's for the burial department. It says, "This sad scene represents the soldiers in the act of collecting the remains of their comrades, killed at the Battle of Gaines Mill and Cold Harbor. It speaks ill of the residents of that part of Virginia that they allowed even the remains of those they considered enemies to decay unnoticed where they fell. Among the unburied on the Bull Run field, a singular discovery was made, which might have led to the identification of the remains of a soldier. An orderly, turning over a skull upon the ground, heard something within it rattle, and searching for the supposed bullet, found a glass eye." It's a wonderful narrative. It's vivid, it's visual in all kinds of ways. But what it does is actually prepares you, or even prompts you, to think about how you should see the photograph. And in fact, when you turn the page, literally, you confront the photograph. And the photograph can either confirm or contradict the text that you've read. And so in many ways, the photograph is slavish in its original orientation to the kinds of words. And even when Gardner tipped in the photograph, he included captions to make sure that that photograph didn't stray too far away from the text that came before it. But I would recommend and suggest to you that the very act of turning the page from the letterpress to the photograph actually kind of broke the relationship between the text and the photograph that was supposed to have followed it. And Gardner wasn't comfortable precisely with that breaking of things, but we would imagine just that kind of conceptual pause between a photograph and its referent and its text opened up the possibility that photographs could actually become rather independent from the things they were supposed to do. And in fact, if we look at the work of that other Scotsman, John Thompson, when he does his illustrations in China just a few years later, in fact, we will notice No captions. No text. It seems like a small thing to us today, because it seems rather familiar to us today to see photographs by themselves on pages without text. But let me just suggest to you, this is a kind of big moment here, right? Where even within a travel account, here's an image that can sit somehow idly and by itself and isolated from the text that's surrounding it and need not make any kind of reference to the text there. Okay, so, let me turn to our second case study. You know, one of the ironies in the history of photography is that after 1929 and the stock market crash, and throughout the kind of horrific economic climate in the 1930s, photography and books blossom. It's a kind of a weird conundrum that's hard even to fathom today. It doesn't seem to create a kind of space and time to permit such a thing, but in fact, it does. And we know that of the many, many books that were produced at this moment in time, one book rises above and stands above all others at this moment, and it is this book by Walker Evans from 1938 called American Photographs here. If we understood John Thompson's singular choice to isolate that photograph on his page without any caption, we might say that American Photographs takes that understanding to a stringent and vehement extreme here, right? But the photograph, in fact, refuses all kinds of textual references. And even though this book has a wonderful, florid essay by the critic Lincoln Kirstein, the essay comes at the back of the book. You have to kind of come to the photographs first here. And even the way in which the photographs are assembled for us, for example, the very first plate in the book, what does it tell us? This is a book about photographs, it says here. Okay. Now, surely some of you might say to me, some of my students have said to me, in fact, you know, but you know, there's a page number down there. And it somehow has to somehow be a gesture towards the textual quality or the bookish quality of this thing. But in fact, that's not a page number, but a plate number. And it's number 8, so we assume it's the 8th plate in this book. And therefore, we would think, well, in a sort of bookish kind of way, it follows the logic of a page sequence. But in fact, it's the 2nd number 8 we see in the book. There's a first plate 8, which refers to part 1 of the book, and a 2nd plate 8, which refers to part 2 of the book. And we're looking at the 2nd plate 8 of this book. You know, we never know these things unless we, in fact, flip through all the photographs themselves to figure out where we are. So even in its bookish format, here is a photo book that insists on photography's kind of resistance to that kind of format here. There are a lot of reasons Evans did this. One familiar reason is that a year prior to the publication of this book, the Museum of Modern Art in New York put together its very first omnibus history of photography exhibition, where it tried to narrate on the walls of MoMA what it took to be a salient and relevant history of photography. And I'm showing you over on the right there an installation photograph from that exhibition. And photographs were hung here and hung there, or they were in vitrines, and they kind of appeared on walls in very willy-nilly kinds of ways. And it was a kind of wild, almost European montage, like installation of these photographs. And here was Evans saying in his book that photographs instead ought not to be treated like pages in a magazine, but in fact, with its generous white space around it, ought to be given the same kind of preciousness as paintings were then obtaining at the Museum of Modern Art. And if we look at, for example, his own installation of this exhibition of American photographs in 1938 at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, we will see that his photographs, in fact, occupy this tremendous white space around it and demand for themselves the kind of display and viewing that was normally reserved for modernist painting at this time. But here's the rub. I'm going to kind of go back to our independence but dependence. So much of what we see in this installation of Evans's photograph, also suggests to us that here are pictures that are offered to us as if they were pages in a book. There's no framing around them, there's no glass on them, there's as if they're kind of laid out in the book itself. And, you know, we reach a weird conundrum. The book insists that photographs ought to be treated like paintings on a wall, but the photographs on the wall insist they ought to be treated like pages in a book. And it's this kind of weird tension back and forth between these two things that suggests to us even someone like Evans understands that photography in its proper display kind of sits somewhere between those two things, on the wall, but also frequently in the book. And it ought to be thought of as going back and forth between these things. Okay. Finally, I'll skip past this one. Finally, let's get to our third case study. When the photo books in the 1930s began to blossom, it opened floodgates that were never closed again. And in the 1940s and the 1950s, more and more and more publishers got into the business of producing and distributing photo books. And they are among the most beloved photo books in the history of photography. Paul Strand's Time in New England from 1950, Robert Frank's The Americans from 1958-59 or so, for example. Even Evans's own other kinds of books like this. In 1962, this artist from Oklahoma City, who had begun art school out in the suburb of California, and who traveled regularly back and forth between Oklahoma City and California on Highway 66, began to take note of this incredibly long voyage and decided to take photographs of the things he found. The artist was Ed Ruscelli. The photographs he took were of the countless gas stations he ran across on Route 66. And the book he put together based on this experience was 26 Gasoline Stations. Okay. If, as I mentioned to you, one of Stephen's proposals to us in his introduction, that photo books are about place, we might say that here is also a book that establishes for us an insistence on placeness. And yet, for someone like Ruscelli, the places that he found all seem so similar to each other. And it was not only the revelation of these places, it was also kind of a banality of these places that he wanted to insist on for us. Even the kinds of gas stations he took pictures of were standard stations, he said. Now we know standard is Standard Oil or Chevron, but also for someone like Ruscelli, this suggested to us the generic quality of these things. He put together these photographs and these books, and it emboldened him to put more of these kinds of little books together that were concerned with place. And I love the titles of these. Let me read some of the titles for you that he put in other books. Various Small Fires, Some Los Angeles Apartments, Every Building on Sunset Strip, 34 parking lots, 9 swimming pools, real estate opportunities. It would sense that all of these photographs have something to do with place. But typical of someone like Boucher, place is always going to be conveyed to us only to reveal to us something of their kind of utter banality and mundaneness and commonness here. And yet, for someone like Boucher, this revelation of place, this insistence on exploring place, was best conveyed to a viewer within the confines of a book. And in fact, you know, I've seen many of Ruscelli's books in museum displays, and in those settings, they're incredibly maddening to look at because you can only see one or two photographs as they are opened up for us. And what you really want to do is finger that book and work your way through it and see page after page after page after page of gasoline stations. And even more so, when you pick up a book by Ruscelli, you begin to realize, as that photograph on the right will tell us, that there's something quite tactile about this book that has a kind of cheap, paperback quality to it. It's not some fancy art book, but in fact the kind of book that all of us experience at some level pretty much every day. And for him, that wasn't just ancillary or happenstance to the kind of making a book. It was fundamental. You know, here are books, and here's the bookishness of photography in his next collection of books. Okay, so I better stop here and turn this over to these characters, and thank you very much once again.